Welcome to today's service. It's wonderful to have you with us, and I look forward to sharing this Christmas Eve morning service with you. Our call to worship comes from Psalm 96. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvellous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be revered above all gods. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Worship the Lord in holy splendour. Tremble before him all the earth. We sing together, Silent Night. This is a service of Christmas carols, and we're going to be doing our readings there. It's the single reading from Luke, but split into four parts. So our first reading this morning is Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 27. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The whole Christmas story is something of a puzzle. Why Mary? Why Joseph? Why Bethlehem? Why a manger where animals are fed? Why wise men and shepherds? Often the answer will be that it fulfills the words of the prophets, but I think that rather misses the point. What is God trying to do here? If this is part of a great plan, then why do things this way? Why are things so, well, back to front? It's a little like those Wasgidge puzzles that turn everything around so that you're looking in the opposite direction to what's shown on the box. All of which makes me think that in some respects what we're looking at is designed to make us reflect on ourselves rather than the panorama laid out before us. What if the Christmas story is designed to have us examine ourselves, to think about who we are rather than who Mary is, to think about what God is saying to us rather than what God is saying to Mary, to ponder how we are related to the house of David, not through direct line of descent, but through adoption. To put it in the context of a Wasgidge, what do Mary and Joseph see when they look out of their little nativity scene toward me and toward you? We sing together, O little town of Bethlehem.
Yet in thy dark street shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. Ooh, how God imparts to human hearts the blessings of his hand. No ear may hear his coming, but in this world of sin, where meek souls will receive him still, the dear Christ enters in. Ooh. O holy child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in, be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel.
We pray. The joy of discovery, that moment when hope and expectation were gloriously met by the illumination of one bright star. We cannot imagine what words were spoken by visitors, or if first impressions left them confused. Messiah, Saviour, a king, born in the barest of palaces. Yet they saw and fell down on their knees in adoration. Lord, they saw you and knew whom they had met. As we meet around crib, candle or advent wreath, draw us into that stable in our imagination. in the quiet moments of prayer this Christmas, that brief oasis from the bustle of the world. Bring alive to us the smell of the hay, the sound of the animals, the cry of a baby. Draw us close to our Saviour, Messiah and King, as we bring not gold, myrrh or frankincense, but the gift of our lives, the only offering we can bring. Lord, hear our private confessions as we bring them to you. May the man born as the Son of God shower you with grace and forgiveness this Christmas season. Amen. Our second reading, also from Luke 1, verses 28 to 33. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favoured one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favour with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." I wonder if they would look at us and be puzzled. Puzzled by what we have made their experience into. Puzzled at how we've turned their somewhat distressing but still rather private family experience into an event. An event that requires spending money that many people cannot afford on things they don't really need. An event that brings out crowds of people to sing together, drink together, eat together, fight together. Or to be reminded of how disconnected we have become. To remember those we've lost. All because a small person was born 2,000 years ago. I suspect that Joseph and Mary would have been far more perplexed looking at what we have done with their story than they ever were at the angel's words. It's almost as if we've taken the intimate birth of their first child and turned it completely upside down. What might we have lost in the process? We sing together, "Carol Our Christmas." May the peace of Christ this Christmas season be with you. Our next part of the reading is Luke chapter 1, verses 34 to 37. Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her, who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Luke's main theme throughout his writing is to remind us that Jesus is God. Everything we read is designed to impress on us that this is not your normal, everyday baby. This is the Son of God. All of which is great for us because it sets the stage for everything to follow. The Son of God is different to us. The Son of God experiences life differently to us. The Son of God is free from the curse of sin. The Son of God sees everything, hears everything, knows everything because, well, God. I have this feeling that God looks at us at this point and is puzzled. Because Jesus came to the world as a very real, very normal human baby. Leaving aside the strange ideas that have been generated since his birth, we know nothing about Jesus as a child until he turns 12. Even the story of his venture into the temple raises more questions than answers. Perhaps there is a purpose in this gap. Leaving aside that gossip abhors the absence of information, the gap allowed Jesus to grow and mature into the adult we meet at his baptism. The work of the Holy Spirit over that time didn't cease. He didn't cease to be the Son of God in the intervening years. He lived as a kid, as a teenager, as a young adult, as a maturing adult. He experienced life, all of which contributed to the impossible becoming reality. I wonder if he looks out at us with bemusement at our desperate ambition to remake Christmas in our own imagining. We sing together. Our last part of our reading is Luke chapter 1, verse 38. Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. What if the entire point of the Christmas story is tied up in Mary's words, "Let it be with me according to your word"? Instead of parading our floats and performing our carols, setting up stars and lights and nativity scenes, Christmas is about stilling ourselves before God. Coming to the realization that the unexpected and perplexing and impossible are all attempts to have us look at ourselves and be still with God. To know God, not out of some complex explanation of what may or may not have happened 2,000 years ago. Rather, to know God because God meets with us every day. The God of Christmas is the same as the God of today. Yesterday, today, and forever, Jesus is the same. Do not be dismayed because the tidings of good news are for now just as much as they have ever been. We pause for a few moments to be still with our unexpected and perplexing and impossible God. We pray. God of the unexpected and perplexing and impossible, we thank you for the story of Christmas. We thank you for the way we are reminded to pause and consider how we may look when we do our Christmas thing. We thank you that what is most important is our relationship with Jesus. And we thank you that the story of Jesus as a baby reminds us that just as a baby has to grow and mature, so our relationship with Jesus needs to grow and mature. Help us to truly be your Christmas people. Through the very human Jesus we pray. Amen. We sing together, "God rest ye merry gentlemen, mixed with Star of Wonders."
God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born upon this day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. From God our Heavenly Father this blessed angel came, and unto certain shepherds brought tidings of the same. How that in Bethlehem was born the Son of God by name. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Oh, 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 star of wonder, star of night, star with royal beauty bright, westward leading, still proceeding, guide us to thy perfect light. Oh, rising in dismay. God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing in dismay. God rest ye merry gentlemen,
God rest ye merry
dismay. God rest ye merry
gentlemen. We bring our gifts and offerings before God. We pray. Gracious and generous God, we offer our gifts to you, knowing that the energy exerted in our giving is tiny compared to what we've expended finding the gifts for our families and friends. You've given us a glimpse of the gift you truly seek in the angel's conversation with Mary. When told that she would give birth to our Saviour, she simply said, "Yes, let it be according to your word." May that affirmation of faith and obedience be the gift we offer this day. In Christ we pray. Amen. We continue with our prayer for others and ourselves. As we rejoice at the birth of Jesus, our Saviour, we turn with confidence to God our Father, praying that the peace and light which Christ brings will be welcomed into the world. For the Church, that the people of God will always be a light to the world for those who live in darkness. Lord, in your mercy, for peace on earth, that the peace which Christ offers will be a reality for all peoples. Lord, in your mercy, for all who are welcoming a new child into their family, that they may receive this gift of new life with joy and be blessed with patience, health, and strength. Lord, in your mercy, for our own community, that our celebration of the birth of our Saviour will make us more aware of our unity in Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy, for the lonely, the bereaved, the sick, and all those who are suffering in any way, that the light of Christ will shine on them. Lord, in your mercy, God of love, Father of all, the darkness that covered the earth has given way to the bright dawn of your word made flesh. Make us a people of this light. Make us faithful to your word that we may bring your life to the waiting world. We ask this through Jesus Christ, your word made flesh, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit and the splendor of eternal light, God, forever and ever. And we pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We sing our closing hymn together, Te Haere Nui.
Not on a snowy night, by star or candlelight, nor by an angel band, there came to our dear land. Te Haere Nui, Te Haere Nui, Te Haere Nui, glad. glad tidings of great joy. But on a summer day, within a quiet bay, the Maori people heard the great and glorious word, Te Harinui, Te Harinui, Te Harinui, glad tidings of great joy. The people gathered round upon the grassy ground and heard the preacher say, I'll bring to you this day Te Harinui, Te Harinui, Te Harinui, glad tidings of great joy. Now in this blessed land, united heart and hand, we praise the glorious birth and sing to all the earth. Te Harinui, Te Harinui, glad tidings of great joy. Te Harinui, glad tidings of great joy.
And so as we go on from here, may we be the people of the unexpected, perplexing, impossible God who calls us all to be at one with him. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace to a wonderful Christmas.